Josiah reigns in Jerusalem. Josiah restores the true worship of God in the temple, including an amazing Passover celebration. It's the best of days with the worst of days to come. And Paul talks about glorifying God in all that we do. Today on 3-in-1, as we consider 2 Chronicles chapters 34 through 36 and 1 Corinthians chapter 6. Well, we finished yet another book of the Bible today, the book of 2 Chronicles. As many believe, Ezra compiled the books of 1 and 2 Chronicles to encourage the remnant returning from exile in Babylon, returning to rebuild the temple and reestablish true worship of God in the temple. So you may have noticed that the temple itself was a significant character in these chronicles compiled by Ezra. And it's good preparation for us as we enter into the book of Ezra in tomorrow's reading, as finally a remnant returns after a 70-year spanking. And we'll talk about why it was 70 years and why it was a spanking tomorrow. Today, we finish out the second book of Chronicles, chronicling the life of a great king named Josiah, and some really not-so-great kings at the end. But first, Josiah, 8 years old when he was first crowned king. And it said, he did what was right in the sight of the Lord and walked in the ways of his father David. He did not turn aside to the right hand or to the left. And then when he turned 16, he really started to seek God, reforming, ripping down what Manasseh rebuilt. And all of this without even having a Bible. All of this without even having the Word of God. It wasn't until he was 26 years old that they found a copy of the Book of the Law while they were restoring the temple. And then things really kicked into high gear. As soon as Josiah heard the Word, his heart exploded with a love for God, probably overwhelmed with confirmation for what was behind and excitement for what lay ahead. Having clear-cut marching orders must have been such a great encouragement to this young king. Now, when the word of God was read to him, there was good news, but there was also bad news. Since there's always a lag time in sowing seed, Josiah sought the Lord on when God's promised judgments would come for Judah, because Judah forsook the Lord before he was born. So he sent his servants to a prophetess, saying, "Go, inquire of the Lord for me, and for those who are left in Israel and Judah concerning the words of the book that is found. For great is the wrath of the Lord that is poured out on us, because our fathers have not kept the word of the Lord to do according to all that is written in this book." Now God's answer was full of grace and truth. Josiah, the truth is, judgment is coming. But graciously, God will not bring it upon Judah in your lifetime. Now, any less of a man would say, "Sweet, then I'll just kick back and take it easy." But not Josiah. This added even more fuel to his fire as he re-implemented not only the true worship of God in the temple, but he also reinstituted the Passover celebration. And oh, what a Passover celebration this was. The Bible said there had been no Passover kept in Israel like that since the days of Samuel the prophet. And none of the kings of Israel had kept such a Passover as Josiah kept, with the priests and the Levites, all Judah and Israel who were present, and the inhabitants of Jerusalem. And all of this from a 26-year-old king. I mean, imagine how intense all of this would have been. We read over the lives of these kings. We skip over the lives of these kings like they lasted a week. But some of these kings reigned for 50-plus years. And Manasseh was one of these kings. He reigned in wickedness and rebellion for 55 years, just before Josiah. I mean, Ammon was in between, but he only reigned for 2 years. So you see what I'm getting at. All of this was absolutely brand new for everyone. There was likely no one living that participated in the true worship of God in the temple, let alone a proper Passover celebration. And what a leader Josiah must have been. So after reading through his life, I hope that we look at 8-year-olds a little differently, and 16-year-olds, and 26-year-olds, those mile markers in the life of this great king, knowing that God can grip their hearts and he can use them to radically change an entire nation if they live according to God's word. See, Psalm 119:9 says, "How can a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed according to your word." Listen to that verse in the NIV. "How can a young person stay on the path of purity? By living according to your word." See, the word of God is radical, and living according to the word of God will become increasingly more and more radical as our society becomes more and more wicked. And that's what we saw start to happen towards the end of 2 Chronicles, after Josiah's reign. After Josiah's reign, the pendulum swung all the way over to the other end of the spectrum, with wicked kings like Jehoahaz and Jehoiakim and Jehoiachin and Zedekiah that went from bad to really bad over the course of many, many years. And ultimately, God brought those judgments that he had promised to bring. But not before hundreds of years of pleading through the prophets to repent, hoping that he could relent. In verse 15, we read, "And the Lord God of their fathers sent warnings to them by his messengers, rising up early and sending them because he had compassion on his people and on his dwelling place, but they mocked the messengers of God, despised his words, and scoffed at his prophets until the wrath of the Lord arose against his people till there was no remedy." Is there any remedy left for our nation? I'm not sure. But I want to have the heart of Josiah in that even if judgment will not come in my lifetime, I want to work for the Lord in such a way that it could bring about such a revival that God would have his opportunity to relent. See, God takes no pleasure in the death of the wicked. He wants all men and all women to come to repentance. In fact, listen to the word of the Lord from 2 Peter. "The Lord is not slow to keep his promise. He is not slow in the way that some people understand it. He's patient with you. He doesn't want anyone to be destroyed. Instead, he wants all people to turn away from their sins. But the day of the Lord will come like a thief. The heavens will disappear with a roar. Fire will destroy everything in them. God will judge the earth and everything in it. So everything will be destroyed. And what kind of people should you be? You should lead holy and godly lives. Live like that as you look forward to the day of God. It will make the day come more quickly. On that day, fire will destroy the heavens. Its heat will melt everything in them. But we are looking forward to a new heaven and a new earth. Godliness will make its home there. All of this is keeping with God's promise." See, God keeps his promises, and that goes for the good, and that goes for the bad. And we saw that clearly at the end of the book of 2 Chronicles. "If you forsake the Lord and you forsake the Sabbath year of rest, then I will take you out of this land and give the land rest myself." But then, as God also promised for the good, after 70 years, he brought them back. He brought them back to rebuild and restore, a remnant returning. And we'll talk about all of that after tomorrow's reading in the book of Ezra. Now, what was today's New Testament reading? First Corinthians chapter 6, starting with Christians in Corinth wanting to sue other Christians. And Paul is astonished. I mean, seriously, what's the most important to you, God's glory or your own personal comfort and security? I mean, that's a serious question for all of us to consider. For the answer will dictate our daily decisions. What is the most important to you, God's glory or your own personal comfort and security? See, if it was God's glory, then you would never sue another believer in front of an unbeliever. And why not rather be wronged, Paul said. That's a powerful question that opens up unheard of, unthought of possibilities. I mean, I didn't even consider that as an option, some would say. But it is. It's an extremely powerful option if the glory of God is your top priority. being willingly wronged without retaliating, that can be an incredible witness to unbelievers as they wonder, why? What's your secret? Why are you so happy and content and not mad? How can you not retaliate? I want to know now. Well, I'm glad you asked. Let me tell you about Jesus and how he washed me and cleansed me and transformed me from within. See, all true believers can say what we just said. And yet we forget that, don't we? We forget where Jesus found us. We forget where he saved us from. But thankfully, Paul is faithful to remind us as he lists for us those who will not inherit the kingdom of God. And you can almost see the self-righteous rejoicing at the beginning of this list. In verse 9, we read, "Do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived. Neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor homosexuals, nor sodomites, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners will inherit the kingdom of God. And such were some of you. But you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God." That is just glorious, isn't it? "But such were some of you." Please don't forget that. And please don't forget that you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God. And all of this together may just make you more merciful when someone wrongs you, remembering where he saved you from and what he had done in your life and what he is going to do.